Welcome to Slash Forward. I hope you appreciate men and the pitfalls and consequences of masculinity, because this week we're going to be looking at the 2011 remake of the 1971 film Straw Dogs, Straw Dogs. We'll watch as James Marsden slices through the atmosphere with his facial structure, completely oblivious to the sufferings of his wife as he struggles to balance the dual responsibilities of getting some writing done and also proving his worth as a man by submitting to the whims and challenges imposed upon him by others. This is a recipe for disaster, and predictably, the movie ends in an extended scene of utter chaos. Although through these trials, I am confident we're going to learn a thing or two about human nature. So let's go along and observe these events while attempting to make heads or tails of them. If any part of the video hits your ear just right, feel free to express that outwardly through utilization of the like button. And be sure to leave a comment identifying your favorite home invasion movie. Let's get to it. We open on a marshy wetland and take just a moment to soak in nature's boundless beauty. But this is ruined upon the assassination of a young buck, who is nearly dehorned before being put out of his misery. We then flash to a young couple cruising the countryside in their fancy Jaguar. Their bouncy, carefree mood wanes as Amy becomes more and more sullen, giving the impression that she is somewhat ambivalent about revisiting her humble roots. This is confirmed through conversation after they stop off at Blackie's for some barbecue. She and her husband David only briefly discuss the culinary merits of the fried pickle before old Charlie saddles up and demonstrates an unsettling familiarity with Amy. Through this brief conversation, we learn that Amy has become an actress and David is a screenwriter. They've returned to town to take solitude in Amy's childhood home. Charlie points out that his company has put in a bid to replace the barn roof, damaged in a recent hurricane. As a demonstration of small-town camaraderie, David agrees to hire them before going for a beer. As the grungy locals leer on, Charlie offers Amy condolences over the recent loss of her father. While at the bar, everything is country cordial, until Blackie tries to cut off the coach, causing him to lose his shit and reveal the violent underbelly of the quiet town. When the sheriff arrives to run him off, we're treated to the third and fourth dick-measuring contests thus far, a popular pastime in this town. When the young couple then goes to leave, they find simple Jeremy playing like he's piloting the automobile when his brother Daniel comes to collect him. They drive down the road and David brings up the topic of Charlie, prompting Amy to ease his mind with a roadside handy before they arrive, and David weeps in the face of her childhood home's historic beauty, and it's already filled with someone else's belongings. Regardless, David thinks it will be the perfect space to allow him to concentrate on his writing. And the next day, Amy returns with groceries to find he's already fully moved himself in, taking over the cigar lounge, and has gotten right to work on his epic World War II screenplay. The next morning, the boys arrive bright and early to begin hammering and blasting their rock tunes. David makes a brief visit to the worksite to meet the crew and plead with Charlie to come later the next day so they can get their creative rest. They further impose their country boy familiarity when Bick welcomes himself in later and helps himself to a beer. When David complains about this to Amy, her recommendation is that he nut up and become the official man of the house. David manages to catch them right before noon, which is clock out time for these ardent hunters, and broaches the privacy issue. Charlie agrees to address it if at some point in the future Bick gives David some reason not to trust him. He then smooth sings over with an open hunting invitation. Later on, we get a good view of the boys' work hard, play hard mentality, as Norm expresses his need for plenty of money, and they all note the appealing nature of Amy's general appearance, along with guesses regarding how ripe for the picking she must be. While back at the house, they're engaged in a more intellectual pursuit, playing chess in their nighttime clothes. As is so often the case with amateur chess players, a bit of feistiness leads to an intimate game of try to guess the chess piece that I've inserted into your body. Back at the bar, the coach is regaling the fellas with one of his classically violent and disgusting stories when he gets an itch to warn Daniel to keep a tighter leash on his brother. There's been word that Jeremy has been hanging out a little too close with the girls, and he doesn't cotton to men fraternizing with his daughter. The next morning, the boys roll up just in time to appreciate Amy's body, really soaking it in as an appendix to the prior night's conversation. By the time she arrives at the house, they're already well into their work, but not so far in that they can't take a little break to leer at her. Inside, David exposits about the movie's title.
Bunch of straw dogs.
An old Chinese concept about idols revered and offered up to the gods before being discarded when they're not of use. In this case, the idolatry relates to high school football. Amy then complains about their wandering, lurid eyes, as David steals a taste of her peach and recommends she wear a bra in order to gain their respect, since it's only fair to reap what you sow. Hey, good talk, dick. Instead, she goes upstairs to sow her brains out and teach them boys a lesson, in defiance of her asshole husband. Unfortunately, this act seems to jar something loose in Charlie's brain. When David comes out, he finds the boys miring his straight six before knocking off a bit early, as is their way. Another hunting invitation is offered, but David is heading into town to see if he can find a spot with some cell phone reception. He finds himself right up their ass, making awkward eye contact before being waved on. But when he goes to pass, he nearly runs into a logjam, indicating they play the games of men. In town, David makes his call while his car is getting fixed, and he observes Daniel warning Jeremy to steer clear of young ladies, especially the coach's daughter Janice. Then David meets the assistant coach, who invites him to a preach and play event where the town watches the fellas scrimmage after a rousing sermon, and soon they're praying their balls off, hoping it will help get them a hometown victory next week by showering the team with God's favor. Since David never misses a siesta, he ducks out for a quick wink. Charlie comes out to confront David about turning his back on old JC, revealing that he doesn't think too highly of this city boy, but that city boy attempts to pull a reverse card on him.
Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's wife.
Which is then doubled back on him.
What happens when their neighbor's wife covets you?
Maybe we should all just chill out on the coveting for now. Soon they're all enjoying the festivities and frivolity, eating dogs and singing Freebird. But Jeremy gets a bit too close, causing the coach to deliver a James Woods special on his ass, which he explains away as a necessity for protecting his family. Fun fact, this scene wasn't in the original script. They just happened to be filming when Craft Services told James Woods that they had run out of turkey pinwheels. His excessive response fit in well as it required Amy to interject. David then becomes angry with her for getting involved, but she's angry with him for not stepping up. The rift between them closes quickly, however, when David finds their pet cat hanging in the wardrobe. Amy suspects it was the roofing crew, which explains their late arrival to the picnic. At any rate, she opens the floor safe and pulls out a hefty sidearm for protection. The next morning, the rift is back on as Amy's insistent David confront them about the cat issue. His plan is to casually mention the cat has gone missing to gauge their response. So he welcomes them in to check out his bitchin' bear trap and enlists their help in mounting it on the wall while set, as one does. But Amy puts a heel on her hubby's nads by delivering the afternoon beers and then making a show about catcalling. They look a little anxious and then push hard about David accompanying them on a hunt. Feeling the sting of his damaged masculinity, he relents and agrees to go, much to Amy's consternation. Soon they're all out there in the fog, wallowing in the musk of machismo while discussing the nature of God. Then, as is natural for a first-time hunt, they all split up and go in separate directions. David ends up under attack by both machine and nature alike. As they head east to track the buck, Charlie has left the hunt and circled back to see how Amy's doing after the mysterious disappearance of her cat. He forces his way in and compliments her on her fragrant aroma, while making himself perfectly at home. When she insists on him telling her why he's even there, he opts to show her instead by forcing himself on her. Then, as David finds and shoots his quarry, reinforcing mankind's dominance over nature, it's revealed that Charlie has brought Norm along, which is even more disgusting. When the tension subsides, David finds himself ditched and trying to hitchhike back to town. The sheriff rolls up, having gotten multiple calls about a man with a gun on the road, and David discovers through this conversation that it's actually not even hunting season. When he gets home, he complains to Amy about how her friends have treated him, and this prompts her to level the charge that both she and him are cowards, which he takes offense to. She then expresses her desire to put this shit town behind them, but now he's insistent that he will not be run off from his own home. The next morning, David decides to officially fire the crew for their poor work ethic and illegal pranks. He calls Charlie in and settles up for about $5,000.
They'll be cash only.
And old Charlie gets in one last joke. Then that evening, Amy reveals that if they're staying, they have to fit in, and the whole town spends Friday nights at the game. As the game starts up, Janice uses her father's distraction to insist Jeremy accompany her on a walk. Their destination ends up being the locker room, where she presses into him and steals a kiss. But the coach only really has two instincts, directing his team toward victory and protecting his daughter's sexual purity. So it's not long before he recognizes her absence. When he's told she was last seen talking to Jeremy, he knows what's up and fully leaves the game to go find her. She's about to round another base when Daddy walks in, putting Jeremy into a panic. In his attempt to keep Janice as quiet as possible, he ends up killing her, which is the quietest anyone can be. Back in the bleachers, creatures, Amy is too haunted by the memory of what happened to stick around. As they leave, the coach is pulling together a search party. If only they knew that David already found Jeremy, suffering a simple open compound spiral fracture of the forearm. And with the closest hospital being 40 miles away, David insists on taking Jeremy back to their house to await the ambulance. Unfortunately, the posse hears about the ambulance call on their scanner, so they commence to rolling out. When they arrive, Charlie tries to talk him out, but the coach gets all riled up and escalates the situation. David has taken on Jeremy as his responsibility and refuses to turn him over, suggesting instead that they go search for Janice. But the coach wants the ground stained red and compels Charlie to action. But before anything can really pop off, the sheriff rolls up to adjudicate the issue. After calming the men mildly, he attempts to get David to send Jeremy out, but he'll only comply if the state police are called in. Then their parlay is interrupted because they left the coach armed and unsupervised. After a period of disorder, these humble roofers rally and commit to breaking into the house for a multiple murder. As David takes measures to secure it from the inside, the men begin to bash and pound on the exterior as Amy wonders how they'll keep them out. David insists he can hold them off, but explains this in an unnecessarily aggressive manner, and also takes a rock to the dome. He enlists her help momentarily to get the bear trap off the wall and set, and then sends her upstairs to hide away with the gun. Then he casually begins prepping some potato gnocchi, confident that they have plenty of time due to the steel door out front. When the most innocent of the men tries to come through a window, David makes him a part of the house, and mercilessly leaves him there as a shard of glass slowly cuts into his neck. After that, when the coach prairie dogs through another window, he hits him with the hot oil, before focusing on putting out the curtain fire they started. Now, feeling the invigorating thrill of ultraviolence, David hardens his heart and puts on some tunes, as if to playfully welcome them in. They take him up on this by ramming the side of the house with their truck. Amy fires on them, but David insists she stop and save her bullets for if they infiltrate the final stronghold. A consequence of this was Norm clocking their location and getting an idea, which is not something you want from Norm. He sets the barn on fire, but saves one ladder, with which he intends to scale the outside of the house. As soon as they get inside the house, Charlie takes a nap. David lies in wait and is able to acquire the coach's gun and blast him in the chest. Bick then refuses to heed his warnings to stay back, so David grabs a fire poker and inflicts ample violence on his ample body. Charlie then faces him down, but they both spring into action when Amy gets to screaming. They find Norm in the bedroom going off script, so Charlie draws down on him. After a brief standoff, Charlie stands down, and then Amy steps up. Now it's boss battle time as Charlie and David are left to go mano a mano. Finding himself outclassed in every way and getting his ass kicked all over the house, David attempts to avoid further hitting by putting on his glasses. But this only prompts Charlie to convert to his gun. Amy then emerges and provides a brief distraction, which allows David the opportunity to help him try on a bear trap necklace. As he slowly bleeds out, Amy seems somewhat disgusted by this turn of events. He then staggers outside to weep as the roof he recently paid $5,000 for goes up in flames. Straw Dogs is a movie that I both like and dislike, and I'm not sure which direction I lean more heavily. There seems to be a somewhat recent trend of revenge movies being helmed by women, providing those films a degree of authenticity they wouldn't otherwise have. This isn't the case for Straw Dogs in that it was directed by Rod Lurie. I went into the film wondering how that would play out, but it ended up working because the film ultimately wasn't that type of revenge film. Instead, it focuses on the complexities of masculinity. To that end, I think it did pretty well by providing several threads that explored this issue from different perspectives. Although, for a film this long, I do wish that it did a little more with these themes. There were a couple of places within the movie that made it seem like multiple storylines were coming to a head, but didn't always provide the payoff that was implied. I have to assume that the remake fumbled some of the themes and story elements that were prominent in the original, because the original seems to be very highly rated. But it did try pretty hard to make it work, and it was a tense and well-made movie. I had initially thought this was a revenge-style movie because I was aware of it featuring a prominent rape scene. That is the point where this film begins to wane for me in terms of the good-bad dichotomy. Specifically, the event in question happens with no real connection to anything else that occurs later in the movie. It's perpetrated in secret without David's knowledge. Then Amy never reveals it to him, and it's never revealed by anyone else. I would think its revelation would be important due to the overarching themes already mentioned, but even if that wasn't the intent, it should also be pointed out that it plays no part in how the ensuing story unfolds, and other than the fact that it causes Amy to become withdrawn, it doesn't really add or elucidate anything regarding her character arc. I don't necessarily subscribe to the idea that each scene in a movie has to drive the plot forward or have some explicit purpose. Experimentation is fine, but what is the value value in making a disconnected or experimental scene centered around this type of suffering. To the director's credit, it was not shot in an overly sexualized or salacious manner, but it leaves me with the impression that there's some major theme or plot point that existed in the original film that they just completely missed or cut in the remake. Without this connection, and in light of some of the other shortcomings of the story, I can say this is a good movie, but it's hard to say that it's an enjoyable movie, or that it has rewatch value when you know you're gonna have to sit through an unnecessary double rip. Before we go, I'd like to give a huge thanks to my donors, memorialized in the Hall of Headshots. I have a website set up where you can support the channel through donations or merch. Any donation unlocks uncensored movie reviews of Life Force, Under the Skin, and Possessor, with others to be added over time. And if you enjoyed the video, I would love for you to become a part of the channel by subscribing. Thanks for watching.